Hey everyone, TheSighBored here, together with Auto Shift today. We are currently on the Kawasaki Vulcan S, the latest Vulcan model coming from Kawasaki. I have to say though, right out the door, this is actually my first time riding a cruiser style bike. That's right guys, before this I've never ridden a cruiser style bike, so this is actually a new experience for me. Hope you can bear with me on this. The main thing that I am actually trying to cope with is the riding position, because easy riding or cruiser position is definitely not something that I'm used to. In fact, true story, whenever I get on this bike for the first few times, in fact, even occasionally right now, if I get off the bike and I get back on it again, I will actually fold my leg or my knee, I guess, to look for the pack like a normal Street Fighter or sport bike position. Because I'm so used to it. So right now, let's talk a bit about the bike then, right? Because that's what you guys are here for. So a quick breakdown of the bike. It has a 650cc parallel twin taken from the ERSIC line. The bike weighs about 225 kgs, which actually is a quite heavy bike for the weight that is 225. However, since it's a cruiser bike, the weight is actually all quite low, the center of gravity and the weight is all down low, so you don't actually feel it when you're pushing the bike. Let's say you're maneuvering the bike in a parking lot or stuff like that. So yeah, I would say it's quite heavy for 225, but you don't actually feel the weight unless maybe you drop the bike. Maybe that's a different story. So apart from the weight, what else is there for the bike? This bike actually produces slightly less power than the ER6 bike. It's actually roughly 60 horsepower for this bike. Why is it low? Well, I'm guessing that since it's designed to be a cruiser, it's not the type of bike you are going to gun down the highway and racing sport bikes with this bike. Definitely, I don't think that's what you're going to be doing with this. Next will be the key features, or the key points that I would like to talk about will be the fuel tank. The fuel tank is about 14 liters. Now, 14 liters, I think it's a bit on the small side compared to average. However, since the bike is not producing that much horsepower, and also you're not going at so crazy speeds, you should have a fairly good fuel mileage, I guess. Unfortunately, I can't be giving you the breakdown on the fuel mileage and so on, because I'm only having the bike for just a very short time, a few hours, I guess. So I'll do the best that I can do with the time I have with this bike for you guys. I guess I stepped on some oil patch earlier at the petrol station, so the foot peg is a bit slippy. That's actually quite dangerous. Damn it. Luckily the bike tires didn't touch the oily patch, or there might be a bad situation. Now for the looks and the initial impression, the looks of the bike, I would say that this cruiser bike has an updated look for it. It doesn't look like all those classic bikes or retro cruisers that you might be familiar with. So it has an updated look. It looks more modern, more stylish. I have seen the LED brake lights in the night when I was traveling back once, and those lights looked pretty darn good. The engine design, it has some chrome features, chrome accent to it. Come on, who are we kidding, right? You don't get a cruiser bike if you don't have any chrome. Am I right, cruiser guys? I tend to mix up cruiser and chopper for this class of bikes simply because I think chopper is an easier term to say than a cruiser. But if I do say chopper, I actually mean cruiser. So please feel free to correct me anyway, I don't mind. I would like to actually try a top speed run right now, but it's actually just after the festive season, Hari Raya, and actually people, there's quite a lot of traffic that are actually trying to get back to their hometowns, or sorry, get back to work, stuff like that. The bike itself, the front of the bike is having a non-adjustable telescopic forks. I believe it's going to be the same type as what you get from a ER6, standard ER6. And the front brakes is a single-sided or single-disc Nissin brake, Nissin caliper. Compared to the ER6, the ER6 actually has a dual front disc compared to this one, which just has one. If you're asking why there's only one, well, I believe cruiser bikes, because of the way it's designed and so on, having two front discs at the front is actually too much braking power, if I'm not mistaken. So that's why they only come with one, or usually just come with one. As for the rear, it's also sporting a Nissin brake. So all around, the brakes are pretty good, standard brakes to have. I'm trying to push the bike more a bit, and I must say I'm really not feeling this cruising position to ride fast. I'm actually using my knees or my thighs to grip the tank because the wind is pushing me back and I need to lean forward a bit. You might notice that I have another GoPro on the bike itself, and that is to face the meter so that you guys can check out the meter reading. I believe I might be too far away for you to see what's being displayed. So you have your usual display for your Kawasaki Vulcan S. The meter itself, I believe it might have been taken from the ER6 as well, or maybe even share the same meter face as the Versys. I'm not 100% on sure of that, but the initial shape of it is telling me that's pretty much what it looks like. You got your standard clock time, odometer, trip meters, you got your fuel gauge, speed reading, and at the top you have your analog RPM or tacho. Control wise, on my right hand side I have the usual engine kill switch in red, and I have the engine start button or switch. On my left, I have the passing switch. Is something like a flash switch which you flash or need to highlight, high beam someone to alert them or something. And you have your high beam, low beam, and you have your hazard double signals. You have your single normal signals left and right. You got your horn. I'm not sure if you heard that. That's my attempt at the top speed. I know it's not a standing starting position top speed. I started off at 4th gear and kicked it all the way up. So I got about close to 174. But realistically, I would say the top speed of this bike is about 170 or slightly below that. Not a very fast bike or powerful bike. But then again, right, this is a cruiser. So we must not forget that we are talking about a cruiser. so we don't want to get confused. All right, so yeah, I just scraped the pegs a bit. My bad. All right, this bike, all right, the handling of this bike is just fine. Feels quite nimble and agile, as you can see. Very less input that I need to give it for it to want to tilt or tip in for the turn. However, it's a cruiser once again, so it's got a low foot pegs, low position foot pegs. You can take it for a sporty ride, but you're definitely not going to be getting some really low cornerings on this. In fact, I think the foot pegs themselves have a pretty large there's something below the foot peg. I don't know what you're going to call that piece, but it's meant to protect the foot peg from, I think, getting caught on the road, so it grinds. It's actually a metal piece. I think that piece is actually quite huge, because I think they're expecting a lot of people to grind those pieces. Well, sometimes it just happens, you know, guys. You're just so used to riding naked bikes and sport bikes that you forget that you're on a cruiser. Go in for the corner fast, scrape the pegs, and you'll be like, oh shit, I totally forgot about the foot pegs. Okay, let's get back to the review then. Now, we're going to talk about the riding position of the bike. This is a cruiser style riding position, so it's definitely a laid back position. You're not lean forward. The seat is nice and comfortable. Big soft seat for you. For the pillion, the seat looks also not too bad for the pillion. So riding position, for the handlebars, I think maybe my hands are a bit short, or could be I'm just not used to, you know, having my arms stretched out like this. But I might feel that the arms, the handlebars are, could be a bit closer to myself. But it could be just me, because I'm not used to it yet, and like I said, this is my first time ever on the bike and riding it. So this is my first time experience, just sharing it with you. Side mirrors, I'm not too much of a big fan of the side mirrors, but I have actually seen some guys terbalik the side mirrors, or what we call fix them on upside down, where the side mirrors actually come from the bottom, outwards somewhere here, which was pretty cool. It cleaned up the top end of the top part of the bike, making it look more sporty, more aggressive. Or you can opt for bar end side mirrors if you want to. Accessories wise, well, I believe there are accessories. You can have your luggage as usual, side boxes, top boxes, stuff like that. But I'll say that this bike is definitely not a bike that you are planning on riding fast. If you are planning on riding fast, I'm guessing that you're gonna put a huge windscreen right in front, and I would say that actually spoils the look of the bike. This cruiser bike actually has something like a sportster or a sporty cruiser kind of look and feel to it. So you are definitely going to find the appeal to the younger generations who are into choppers into cruisers, but can't quite yet afford those Harleys or what other bike? Their Victory bike? I don't know, those really expensive cruisers. So how much is this bike? The bike itself, I believe, is in the low 30s. So it's pretty reasonable bike to have, actually, as a first bike. Is it difficult to ride? Nah, I don't think so. It's actually pretty easy. Whoa, here we got a corner again. I must remember not to tip it in too much. Now the engine itself, like I said earlier, it's actually a parallel twin engine taken from the ER6. But of course the outer design of the engine is totally different. So it's looks exactly like an ER6 engine. It has those chrome shiny accents to it, which is cool. So about the engine, since it's a parallel twin engine, it doesn't vibrate as much as you might expect from maybe a V-twin engine. That makes the bike having less vibrations, and in general the comfort is pretty good. Here we are at KLIA2. I guess you could call it the newest airport. So we are actually doing a simple test, I guess. Testing out the brakes and suspension. What did we test with? The wonderful speed bumps, of course, obviously. Oh man, these corners are so tempting, but I know I can't lean the bike too much. So what can we conclude from our simple test just now with the brakes and suspension? Well, I must say that the suspension is, I wouldn't call it soft for the makeup of this bike. Let me check where the heck am I going, Kuala Lumpur. Yeah, we just had a quick roundabout at KLIA2, just for fun, because why? Riding is fun, riding is damn awesome, and we can do whatever we like. Go wherever we want. No tolls to pay, bro! Woohoo! Yeah, this bike definitely pops you off the seat if you are going through some really bumpy roads. As for the brakes, I must say the brakes are okay for me. But like I said, I'm used to more grippy brakes. So as my benchmark of my own bike compared to this bike, definitely the braking feel is much less. It doesn't mean it doesn't want to stop. It's just that you have to grab harder. No big deal, right? If you're going at a relatively casual pace, it shouldn't be a problem. So we just had another quick top speed run, but this time it was actually a fifth gear roll-on, hard roll-on. Managed to get it close to almost 178. So realistically, I would say that the top speed is, you can probably get 170. That should be it for the top speed. It's not bad because I would say that in terms of cruising, to enjoy the ride, that kind of stuff, normally for myself I would say 140, about 140 to 150. That should be actually quite the ideal pace or ideal speed you want to maintain. So this bike having a top speed of just about 170, I don't think it's a big deal, since that if you are cruising, maintaining an easy riding pace of about 140 or 150, then I don't see the issue. What's the point of needing a crazy top speed of let's say 220, 240? If your cruiser can go 240, I don't think you can maintain the pace though, because you're gonna get bashed by the wind pretty severely, and it's not going to be an easy ride anymore. Okay guys, I guess that's enough about my ramblings, or more likely a review on this bike, the Kawasaki Vulcan S. In summary, I would say that this bike, like most of the new bikes that come out of the factories nowadays, especially the Japanese bikes, they come in a pretty good package right now. Of course, it doesn't have all the electronics, bells and whistles, like traction control, ride-by-wire. It doesn't have all these fancy gadgets, but that's what keeps the price down. So for myself, in summary, it comes in a good package, the Vulcan S. The price is pretty, I would say, pretty interesting or pretty appealing. It's not too costly. Bikers are first-time bikers that get this bike. They're definitely not going to say that this bike lacks power. It has a good talky feel because of the parallel twin. Man, the sun must be frying my brain. So anywho's, in summary, yep, we're still doing the summary. I don't know why it's so long, it's supposed to be a summary. I would say that I would give a thumbs up on this bike from Kawasaki. Good effort making the bike number one, affordable. Number two, it comes in a good package. The weight balance of the bike is pretty low, so even small size riders, whether you are not a strong man, you definitely can handle the bike. And if you're not tall, come on, do you really need me to do a height showdown for this bike? Okay, I will. Okay, so this is me. I am 169 cm tall. This is the bike. Let me sit on the bike and I'll show you how it looks like. Okay, so this is me on the bike. As you can see, I got my foot down, both feet down, very flat. Knees are bent. So this is a very low profile bike. The seat is very low. So I guess, let me put the feet up. Alright, this is how I look on the bike. Okay, so that's about it guys. Let me get out of here. So this is a cruiser style. It's low, it's low seated. You're definitely not going to have any issues with this bike in terms of height. However, in terms of the handling, I mean in terms of the clearance you need, because of the rake, this bike is a bit stretched compared to the normal sporty sport bikes or the naked bikes. It's a bit stretched out, so you might need to bear in mind, if you are still new to the bike, you need to bear in mind on that, which is also one of the reasons why I am not taking this bike on my first ever ride through heavy traffic that I need to maneuver or weave through. I'm doing it on the highway because this is a cruiser, guys. You're supposed to be cruising, not trying to weave through traffic or not trying to go through traffic jams. As my friend once said, and I quote, Santai Janji Sampai. So that's it, guys. I know this review is a bit all over the place, and I apologize for that. I hope you guys were entertained from the review and got some good information, and probably helped you in making your decision whether you should get this bike if you are interested in it. So till the next one, guys, ride safe, safe ride.